We are joined right now by our friend Jennifer Rubin. You know her, you love her, from the Washington Post, the author of the Right Turn blog. Hello, Jennifer.
Hi, how you doing?
I got to tell you, I admire you so much. We don't always agree wholeheartedly on everything, but that's not what I'm getting at. You know, I'll go to your blog and I'll read something and say, okay, here's what I'm going to talk about with Jennifer. Then I go back, you know, 15 minutes later and there's two more stories on there and I say, oh my God, I got to update this. So I love the fact that you got, you know, so much to say and yet you presented brilliantly. You don't need me to tell you that. And there's always so much to talk about with you.
Well, thanks, Steve. That's very kind of you.
All right, so let's start with this Common Core. These education standards. Tomorrow, I do a commentary at the end of every hour called "Give Me Five." I got this mother who was in one state, saying she was sent there by teachers, administrators, everybody, and she presented this math problem, and she said, you know, how would you normally do that? And someone in the audience said, you multiply by five, and she said, yes, but if you did that on the test under Common Core, you would fail. Because you now have to draw diagrams and go through like 25, 30 different things to get to the same answer. They don't want you memorizing multiplication tables anymore. And I remember my dad, may he rest in peace, I remember staying up literally till 3, 4 in the morning when I was a little kid. I just remember this pounding into my head, the memorization of the multiplication tables. And that's just one example. Talk about Common Core. You talk about it in the case of George Jeb Bush and how it might hurt him or it could help him, depending on how we all view Common Core down the road. But I don't view this as a left or right thing. I just think it's a bad thing.
Well, I think the lady must be mistaken, because Common Core does not talk about curriculum. That's what she's talking about, the substance of how you teach things and whether you read this book or that book or the technique that you use for multiplication. What it does is set certain standards. By the end of the eighth grade, you should be able to do multiplication. By the end of, you know, 10th grade, you should have mastered algebra. What it is this, first of all, it's not the federal government, as a lot of our friends on the right claim. It's a bunch of states that got together and came up with what they thought were going to be more challenging standards. The reason for the concern is that we are getting our tails whipped by the Asian countries, by some European countries, that we are falling behind internationally. And this was an attempt to try to hold American kids to a higher standard. That sounds good to most people. It sounds good to me. I have different concerns about Common Core than some of these other issues that you've heard that have been very politicized. One is, I'm not sure we have the teachers that can teach these things. They're not doing a good job teaching at substandard levels. How are they going to teach the kids more and accelerate the learning? You know, there's lots of concerns about teacher quality, and I tend to think that that's really the nub of the problem, the teacher training, the teacher quality. There are lots of other issues, of course, in American education that come from outside the classroom. You and I in the past have talked about inequality. We've talked about the breakdown of the family. We've talked about the difficulty of single mothers raising kids. But I think the Common Core, listen, we're going to have a big competition. Bill Gates himself said it not too long ago at a meeting at the American Enterprise Institute. We'll have a great marketplace to test this. Some states will do Common Core, some states won't. And then after you've had data for a few years, we can begin to see, well, gosh, the states that didn't have Common Core actually improved more than the states with Common Core, or maybe it's the reverse. So I think it's worth trying on an experimental basis. Let's be honest, the schools can't get much worse. We've been pouring money into the schools like it's nobody's business.
Right.
And if they want to do something that actually doesn't immediately cost money but actually goes to quality, I'm willing to give it a shot, you know, within reason, obviously. And you're going to have some states that aren't going to go forward. I believe Indiana is one of them. And Mike Pence, who's the Republican governor, said, listen, we have our own standards that we think are high and are going to be successful for our kids. That's great. Let's see. Maybe the Indiana standards are going to be great. Everyone's going to run around and pick up Indiana's idea. That's the laboratory of democracy. That's what federalism is about. So I guess my view is let 1,000 flowers bloom. Let's see what works and what doesn't. But I don't think there's a magic bullet out there, and there's certainly not going to be a magic bullet by suddenly instituting a bunch of standards, because you still have the same kids and you still have the same teachers.
No, that's an excellent point. And let me follow up one thing on George Bush that you didn't write about today that I know of, and that is not George, but Jeb Bush. His statement about immigration, which he made now well over a week ago, that it's an act of love if someone comes here illegally, into this country to feed their kids or better their family. And I wonder where, I just think that's going to hurt him so much because, where do you draw the line? By that logic, if there's a person who's unemployed and their kids, need food or whatever, could he rob a grocery store? Could he shoplift? I mean, where do you draw the line on that kind of sentiment?
I think that sentiment has been somewhat misinterpreted. If you look at the whole paragraph that he spit out there, he said, we have to get control of our borders. It should be illegal to come here in an unauthorized fashion. But at the same time, we can have a measure of empathy and understand the motivation for these people. Understanding the motivation and being sympathetic towards the plight of these people does not necessarily dictate the result. And if you remember in his book, he was much more conservative than the United States Senate, for example. He doesn't want to give people citizenship. He's in favor of only naturalization. So I think people make the mistake of jumping two or three steps ahead and concluding, he's going to grant, quote, amnesty to everybody because he feels sorry for people. I think he's simply talking about a measure of empathy, how we treat the people who are already here, making sure that the conversation is respectful and that we understand that there is a major, major difference between the large majority of people who do come to better their life and the small number of really bad apples who we need to separate and send back and get rid of because they commit crimes or they do other things that we don't want them doing. So I think looked at in the whole context, I don't have a problem with his comment. In fact, Rand Paul followed up and said, I would have said it a little differently, but he didn't really disagree with him.
Right.
I think one of the problems Jeb Bush may have, however, is he's not used to operating in this 24/7 media
environment. Soundbite, the world of soundbites, yeah.
Yeah, and he's going to be, if he doesn't learn to speak with a little bit more precision and in a little bit more succinct fashion, he's going to have a tough time. Well, but we'll see if he decides to run or not. That'll be another day.
I want to touch on another piece you wrote today, and that is about the Politico headline, George W. Bush Surprises on White House Records. And basically, this is a story about how the Bush Library is much, of course, now we have the most transparent administration ever, but for libraries, the presidential libraries, the Bush Library, George W. Bush Library, is going to be much more transparent than the Clinton Library has been.
Yeah, the reason I took them to pass for that was, why are they always surprised when George Bush behaves, in a way that they like? I know, it's shocking. He reads books and everything.
He paints, too.
And he sends money to Africa to cure AIDS. Isn't that a shock? Isn't that a surprise? The media is constantly surprised because they have this image of him as some cloak and dagger, sneaky guy. Bush lied, people died. You know what? His administration was 1,000 times more transparent than the current one. He didn't interfere with photographers the way this White House does. He didn't go after to prosecute members of the media. He made him and his staff available for a 9/11 inquest. He made staff available for the inquest into the firing of U.S. attorneys. This president has never done anything remotely like that. So the notion that George Bush was some secretive, closed presidency is laughable when you look at his successor.
Yeah, absolutely. Couldn't agree with you more. Jennifer, always great to talk to you folks. Of course, Jennifer Rubin, WashingtonPost.com, the Right Turn blog there. Don't miss it, and don't blink, because you'll miss another story, another posting from Jennifer. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Steve.
Take care. Jennifer Rubin, ladies and gentlemen, here on the Steve Malzberg Show. I like it when conservatives, don't always agree. I mean, I don't agree with everything Jennifer writes and says, and she doesn't agree with everything I say, which is healthy, and it's good, and it's not a civil war. I know they like to portray the Republicans as always being in a state of civil war. We're not in a state of civil war. Normal disagreements. We're coming back with the panel. Steve Malzberg Show, Newsmax Television.
We don't just talk about the news. We talk to those making news. This is the Steve Malzberg Show.